Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Simon Volta, and I'm the Director of Sales here at V Technologies. Today, we're going to talk about StarShip and the integration with QuickBooks and how we can help streamline your workflow when it comes to your international processing. Before I get started, I'm going to go through a quick PowerPoint for all of you, and then I'll get into the demonstration of how StarShip works with QuickBooks and your international documentation. So as I get started here, I welcome everyone who's currently using our StarShip application today, and those of you using ShipGear or other product, welcome as well. And I'll talk a little bit about the differences between the two and why StarShip is a more robust platform and the reasons you might want to think about migrating over to that platform if you haven't done so already. So I'm going to kick it off here and get started in the presentation. So for those of you new to V Technologies, welcome as well. And we've been around since 1987 with about 30 years experience now in the shipping software industry. StarShip has been around since 1989 and many enhancements made all the way throughout. We have about a 15 plus year relationship ongoing with Intuit, the folks at QuickBooks, and about 10,000 plus customers now using our application across the country as well as in Canada. We do have subsidy programs that are available between UPS and FedEx. I would highly recommend that you speak with your account representative from each of those companies to learn more about how you can qualify for funds if the application is the right fit for you, how it can basically help pay for the whole solution or a part of it. Anyway. So for those of you using ShipGear today, as I said, the main differences are listed here on this screenshot. What you can expect to see in StarShip. So right now, for those ShipGear users thinking about the migration, you're currently using your WorldShip or your Ship Manager application and having ShipGear bring in the information from QuickBooks into those applications and then having it written back into QuickBooks. StarShip is its own user interface, so those two applications would go away and you would use StarShip to basically consolidate all of your carriers, both parcel as well as LTL. It does have the capabilities of incorporating your LTL shipments as well. The line items will all come into StarShip, so we do have the capabilities of bringing your sales, your line items, your sales orders, or your sales invoices into StarShip, whereas today on the ShipGear side, it's only header level information. Third-party applications are supported, so if you're thinking about a pick and pack or an EDI application, we do work with various providers and how we can help streamline that workflow as well. And also in StarShip, you have the capabilities of rate shopping, which is one of the key features I'll show you today, of how we can bring all your carriers into StarShip and show you the negotiated rates that you have negotiated and which one that might be the least expensive to ship with. We also support batch processing. So for these, you might be doing e-commerce. You basically can batch process your orders so you can print multiples at a time. And then as I mentioned, EDI, we do work with various EDI providers. So if you do work with big box retail, such as Walmart, Home Depot, the Lowe's, for example, and you're getting orders daily, we have a way of incorporating that into the workflow in StarShip as well. And then also if you do have an e-commerce site, we can also use as what we call an e-commerce extension, not only right back to QuickBooks, but also look at your e-commerce shopping cart that you're currently using and see if we can also write back the tracking information to that specific order. And then last but not least, we do offer discounted post office rates with StarShip. So you benefit from CPP pricing by being a StarShip user, in which today in ShipGear it's only with UPS and FedEx. So as we talk about international, why would you want to ship international with StarShip? So really, these are the main four points that I like to make, and I'm going to talk more about it in the demo. But really, you're looking to build commodity information for the commercial invoice, as well as your NAFTA documentation. And that's all being done from the line item. So on the line item level, we store your Schedule B information. we also store all the pertinent information that's needed from a value perspective for a commercial invoice. So as long as all the information is stored on the StarShip side of things, anytime you would import any one of your items, that's going to automatically populate and then print at the end when your shipping label's printing all of your international documentation is going to print alongside with it. We also support, and it's not listed here, for those of you using UPS paperless invoicing or FedEx electronic trade documents, we do support that on the StarShip side, so we can have those electronically sent to customs. And then also we do support the ACE integration, or formerly known as AES, for those commodities over $2,500 in value. So if you do have any of those shipments going out, StarShip has a way of transferring the information into the ACE's website, so that way you can file for your ITN number and then bring that back into StarShip so you can complete. This is just a list of carriers that we do work with on a direct basis, anything from LTL or parcel. Today's demonstration, I'm going to focus strictly on parcel shipping, but if it was international to Canada, for instance, you're doing LTL with one of these carriers, we do support that as well. But again, we have about 24 different integrations that we currently support domestically as well as internationally. So for those of you new to StarShip, this user interface is going to look a little different than what you might be using today. For those of you who are currently a StarShip user and wanting to learn more about international, this is all going to look very familiar to you. So really a couple of things I like to point out in the demo. So first and foremost, if your pick tickets or packing lists are barcoded today, we do support like a wedge type scanner to have you scan that in to StarShip to bring in your sales order, your sales invoice. But we do support, just so you know, from a source document, we do support invoices, sales orders, or sales receipts. So any one of three documents we do support on bringing it in. So if you did, like as I mentioned, a wedge type scanner, you can scan in that barcode. It'll bring all the information in. However, if you did want to look up the order, you can use our lookup window, add filters at your leisure and any of these column headers. But if you know which order you're working with, you can simply pick and choose from here and load that document into StarShip. So once that all the information comes in, it's going to populate all the pertinent information. So it's going to bring in your ship via information from QuickBooks. So in this situation, I had it set to UPS. This shipment happens to be going to Canada. So it's going to be being shipped ground to Canada. But also it's going to be billing your account number as a default. We do support third-party billing options. So if you do have drop ships or you're just shipping third-party, we can map those accordingly back to QuickBooks to a specific field that you will let us know on which field that is, so we can bring in the appropriate account number. And same thing with drop ship addresses. If you want to ship from a different location, we can map to, for example, like a bill to section of QuickBooks, so that way it can reflect the different address or name that you want it to reflect versus your own. The recipient is all brought in from the ship to section of QuickBooks, so all this has come in. If this was a domestic order, we do offer an address validation for domestic. Because it's international, this is grayed out, so we don't do an international address validation. So therefore, this will be grayed out and won't let you do that. Down at the bottom, this is where I was mentioning all the line items before. So on this particular order, I have two line items. I've identified each of these items to be put in its own packaging type. It's an option, it's not a requirement. You can have it default into one box, and you can add cartons onto the right here. You can add a third carton, and you can drag and drop items as you see fit. Again, or you can define that at the beginning, where you can say my cordless drill is going to go into my drill case box, and so that automatically would import the way you see down the screen. At the line item level, all of these are standard mappings we do during implementation. So your item number is what your item number is in QuickBooks. Your description is what's in QuickBooks, along with its unit weight and value. Value is very key in international because this value is going to be used to be placed on your commercial invoice for customs purposes, for duty and tax requirements. So we definitely want to make sure there's a value entered here or mapped at least. The weight is a variable. You can type this in here if you choose to. You can have it mapped back to QuickBooks. Or if you save and ship in process, it will automatically remember what you shipped it as last time. If this was LTL, we would also store your NMFC code along with your class information, so that way you don't have to re-enter that every single time on that particular item number. And then off to the right, we also store your Schedule B information, as I mentioned. So again, that's tied to this specific item number, along with your certificate of origin information, along with all your NAFTA. So all of this is saved on the first time you import your item. So you don't have to redo this every single time. Again, just trying to streamline that from what we hear today from using, say, a UPS WorldShip or a Ship Manager. We're hearing a lot of those complaints on how can we improve and get more orders out the door without doing all this additional paperwork. StarShip kind of takes the place of that. Once you have everything saved in the database, it's pretty much streamlined. You don't have to worry about coming in here every single time. So when I go over to the international tab here, you can see here I have all my parties on who I want to, you know, charge duty and tax to, along with who's paying transportation fees. So you can set that, you know, however you, your business operates. Most people will choose duty and tax to be paid by the recipient and the transportation to be paid by shipper. If you do have a broker, you can definitely specify that information into here. So that way you can just basically tell us who we should, or who, the carrier, who they should drop the package off to or the pallet, so they can clear customs as well. Off to the right is basically the value that we're going to put on the commercial invoice for customs. So again, this is based off the line items themselves and the values that are coming in from QuickBooks. So the total would be $679.90 that you're going to see on the commercial invoice. So again, your commercial invoice is pretty much done, and you don't have to worry about printing a separate document or manually having someone do that for you. And then at the bottom is where we would come into generating and moving information over to ACE. If this value happened to be over $2,500 for one commodity, this is where the U.S. government's going to require you to basically file for an ITN number or an international transaction number to be placed back into StarShip, so that way you can proceed with the shipment and therefore there's no held up at any sort of customs across the world. So as we move into rate shop, so once we get into the rate shop, you're basically going to see default to whatever you brought the order in as. So in this situation, we have it as UPS Standard of Canada. But if I wanted to see all my carriers that I have on my license, I can simply hit shop all. And this will go out and hit each carrier's API that you have licensed and bring back your negotiated rates. The one variable is the post office. It'd be using our rates that we're providing to you as a StarShip user, and those would be reflected on all the shipments that you do as well, as long as it's on your license. So as this brings in all the carriers that I have on my current license, you will notice we can store it by lowest to highest on the charges themselves. And then also you can store it by the delivery times as well. So here I have it stored at lowest to highest. So UPS Standard of Canada is my least expensive option at $59 to bring in or to ship this item. And then if I wanted to pick and choose any other service based on delivery time, I can do that as well. And you'll notice here FedEx Ground is going to get there a day faster. So if I wanted to choose that based on just straight out delivery, I can do that and by just choosing this box here. And then now I have it moved over to my FedEx Ground account that I have already established. I don't have to re-import this whole order over again. So for this situation, I'm just going to leave it as UPS Ground. And then one last thing I like to mention before I ship in process, we do have the ability here to show you kind of your published rates versus your contracted rates versus what we call our applied rate. So the contracted rate is obviously what the carrier is charging you. StarShip has something called freight rules that we can build in behind the scenes. So if you're going to charge a percentage or a flat fee on a particular customer or across the board, we can do that for you. So that way, from an accounting standpoint, it could write back the appropriate amount to be charged back to your customer. In this situation, because I have two boxes, I have a $5 handling fee per box. So there's an additional $10 that I'm going to charge back to my customer. So $69.05 would be placed back in the QuickBooks, or you can just have the contracted rate put back there as well, whichever your preference is. So if I wanted to ship and process the shipment, I can go ahead and do that by hitting the F5 or the tab up top here. Once I do this, my two labels are going to print along with my international documentation. So my two labels will print here. So you'll notice here what we have is called our smart label. So one half of this is your 4x6 thermal label that you can peel and stick to a box. The other half becomes a packing list It is an optional item that you can choose. You can have these both print to your thermal printer. You can turn off the packing list if you choose to do that. It's completely up to you. But again, it's just an option we have, so that way you can have all of your information print together, rather having one document print up front and one document print out back. So I'll get a second label along with its packing list for the box. Then I'll get my certificate of origin. That'll have all the information needed here for the shipment going up to Canada. All my Schedule B information, my description of goods, all of that will be listed here. And then last but not least, I'll have my commercial invoice print behind that. So again, all the information from, you know, its Schedule B information to its unit values, totaling that $600, $679.90 fee that I showed you earlier. So as I bring that order back in here, just to show you the write back, what that's going to look like. So the write back all occurs in real time information, so you don't have to sync up an hour later at the end of the day. So once all these documents print, the write back will have occurred back in the QuickBooks. So if I go back into my QuickBooks sales order that I was working on and locate that sales order, you'll notice I have my two tracking numbers along with the service type used. There's other variable information we can list here as well. So if there's something that you're looking for specifically, definitely inquire with me and we can talk about further write back options in here that we can list. But more importantly, we also put the freight charges at $69.05 back into the sales order. So now you can go ahead and create your invoice. So that concludes the workflow on the StarShip integration with QuickBooks, kind of with international. I'll leave my contact info up here.